Miss Asian America Stephanie Lin is in town, and I decided to catch up with her at a cafe, this time in the heart of Taipei's Cultural Park.
Hello and welcome to Taiwan Today. I'm Natalie So. Today I'm really honored to be with Miss Asian America, the first Taiwanese American Miss Asian America, Stephanie Lin. She's here visiting Taiwan again after her reign, and very happy to talk to her about all the exciting adventures she's been having. Stephanie, it's great to have you on the show.
It's a huge pleasure to be back, Natalie. Thank you so much for having me.
Yes, it's been about over a year since
yes,
we talked last
just about.
And so tell me what you've been up to as Miss Asian America. What were some of the highlights of your year?
So many things. You know, well, one of the big highlights was probably meeting you. being on your program during my press tour in Taiwan. So basically, as Miss Asian America, I was running on the platform of championing women in technology and in STEM. So I think that my team and I were very successful in that sense. So we did a lot of fundraising, raising money for women's scholarships. We also did a lot of talks, lectures, promoting this and encouraging more discussion around the topic of women in technology. You know, when I last came back to Taiwan, I did a big lecture with in partnership with Taiwan Startup Stadium to basically educate startup founders out here not only on, you know, the importance of hiring more diverse, but also how they could promote their businesses on a more global platform, market themselves more globally. So I would say all of these different things in accumulation made for a very successful year as Miss Asian America, and I'm super grateful for the opportunity to have held the crown at that period of time.
Yeah. It really impresses me how beauty pageant winners are not only beautiful, but they're so smart.
Oh, thank you very much.
You know, they're doing so much for the world as well. Mm-hmm. So what do you think about, you know, Taiwan's tech scene? I know you've tried to, and its startup scene, mm-hmm. I know you've tried to encourage it, right? Mm-hmm. And encourage people to build it up. Mm-hmm. What were some of your insights or the way that you're trying to inspire people here?
I think that general observations about the Taiwanese tech scene right now is, you know, there's starting to become more of an awareness in that, you know, we need to shift from, you know, just from being this behind the scenes manufacturer of great technology, but just not having a brand attached to it, like to being this leader in the Internet of Things, IoT. And so I believe that the Taiwanese government recently has started to put a lot of funding behind this initiative of setting Taiwan up as this leader in the Internet of Things. And I'm really excited to see where that growth goes. And also slowly starting to see more of a emphasis in terms of training and education for young startups out here on the importance of self-branding. Like I mentioned just a little bit earlier, traditionally Taiwan has always been this kind of this behind-the-scenes player at creating really great hardware, but there's never been like a Taiwan, like a brand attached to it. Like I feel like very few people know that HTC, for example, is a Taiwanese company, right? So now that there is this big movement or more of an emphasis, I would say, on the importance of branding ourselves as, you know, a Taiwanese entity, or just branding, when building a company, that branding is an important part of that. I'm really excited to see where things go for Taiwan on the global stage.
And how do you, you know, Taiwan is trying to become Asia's Silicon Valley, and mm-hmm. you're from Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
How do you see Taiwan's potential in that regard?
I see a lot of potential because I see a lot of earnest desire amongst young founders out here to really get the word out about their business on a global scale. It's really just a matter of, you know, us having more of a stronger information exchange between the West and here in Taiwan. You know, maybe more talent who are willing to volunteer their time from Silicon Valley to come out here to Taiwan to help educate and teach some of these startup founders on how to, you know, again, self-market, brand themselves, product tips and tricks on how to really build something that resonates with a global audience. I think having more of that information exchange is really going to help these startups and the technology scene here flourish even further.
Well, that's great.
Thank you. I mean, these are just my insights, my personal observations, right, of course.
So it's great that you're trying to help women in STEM and also people in Taiwan. Mm-hmm. That was your platform, right?
Thank you.
And then you went on to adventures in
helping in endangered wildlife in Costa Rica, in Thailand. Tell me what inspired you to want to help wildlife.
Yeah, sure. So, what inspired me to help wildlife, I mean, that really comes from both a practical and a personal it's both a practical and a personal reason why I wanted to help wildlife. You know, the practical being the fact that, you know, our Earth is in an incredibly fragile state right now. The World Wildlife Fund just released a report saying that we've lost about our global wildlife populations have decreased by 60% since the 1970s, and that number could continue to increase, as the years go by if we don't do something about it. You know, we're overproducing carbon in the air. We're producing way too many greenhouse gases, overheating the planet, and so we're starting to see trends like the water elevation, the water levels, the sea levels, the levels going up. We're seeing flooding in certain areas. So the planet is in a bit of trouble from a scientific perspective. So I really wanted to do my part to help with that, to help quell that. And of course, on a personal perspective, I've always just been a big fan of wildlife. I grew up watching a lot of nature and Animal Planet, and so I really wanted to get really hands-on and be able to fulfill sort of this bucket list dream, if you will, of being really close up with just beautiful creatures that exist in our natural world. So
I know you went to Costa Rica to help sea turtles.
Yes, yeah.
Tell me why that, what was exciting about that or challenging about that experience?
It was, being in Austinal in Costa Rica was probably one of the most challenging experiences of my life, but also one of the most incredibly fulfilling. Being in the Silicon Valley, you're around so much wealth, and I really wanted to put myself in a situation where I was around it, where people really just had nothing but their basic necessities and their communities to count on. And so I wanted to put myself in that kind of environment because I didn't want to, be so sheltered, I suppose. So there was that. And just being out, I suppose, in the wild, and you're seeing these beautiful female turtles, and they're coming up to the beach and they're struggling, going through that whole cycle of life, overcoming the odds of, like poaching and fishing nets that are out there that could cause them to drown. They're overcoming all of these obstacles to come onto this beach and lay their eggs. And just getting to, help measure them and touch them and gather data on these animals that will help contribute to their conservation and their protection was incredibly meaningful.
So those sea turtles were so cute.
They're
so adorable. And most of them end up being eaten or
yeah, dying? Only 1 in 10,000 baby sea turtles live to adulthood. That's according to National Geographic. And so they do overcome incredible odds to be able to become adult turtles. And that's why, it becomes even more important that we humans do what we can to help protect them.
Yeah. So so you were there for a few weeks.
Yes.
And then you also moved on to Thailand.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. So I was in Costa Rica for a while, and then I moved out to Thailand to work at a wildlife refuge that also focuses on rehabilitating elephants that were put through the now illegal logging industry, and also who suffered a lot of abuse working in wildlife tourism. And for those who aren't aware, when we go out to places like Thailand, for example, you're going to see a lot of advertisements for things like elephant rides. And you'll see videos of people riding the elephants and everyone's looking like they're having a great time. But actually, unbeknownst to a lot of people is that these elephants have actually undergone a lot of torture and just abuse at the hands of humans in order to become very docile so that they are able to provide these rides to people. The actual process, we were told by the people who run the wildlife refuge is it's called the Crush, where the baby elephant is actually separated from the mother at a very young age, and they put it in a small little cage, and they basically torture it and do all sorts of really terrible things, drive nails through the feet and all that. At some points, it becomes so difficult for the baby elephant that reportedly the elephant will sometimes try to step on its own trunk to suffocate itself because it's so painful. And so this crush process is called the pajan. And so this sort of thing is, obviously, it's terrible for the animal, and I don't believe that a lot of people who, you know, participate in elephant rides are aware that this sort of breaking of an elephant's spirit happens. And if more awareness was done, or if there was more awareness around, I'm pretty sure that we could put a stop to this particular practice, to this particular industry. So, you know, after being aware, made aware of the situation, you know, I've signed up to volunteer in Thailand, and, you know, getting to work alongside, you know, other people who are so passionate about this cause, and just being alongside these incredibly beautiful creatures definitely was the experience of a lifetime for me.
And so how are they helping these creatures?
You know, at this point, it's just making sure that they live out the rest of their lives very peacefully. And also, because centers like this exist, we do invite tourists to come by and get educated on how we take care of the animals here and how they can practice sustainable tourism and not participate in elephant rides and other forms of tourism that exploit the wildlife. Yeah, so what we do at the center was, you know, we feed the elephants every day. We clean out their enclosures. We take them for walks, give them baths, things like that. Yeah.
Make them feel
comfortable,
loved,
help
right.
them. Exactly. Yeah, because a lot of the elephants were, you know, the youngest one we had was 2 years old. But the story for that one was actually quite interesting. She was rescued with her mother, a 30-year-old elephant, from a trekking camp. Her mother was forced to breed and continuously give birth to baby elephants that would be used, that would be put through the crush and used for further elephant rides. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. But most of the other elephants we had were maybe about, you know, 60, 70 years old. And for those, they'd spend much of their lives giving rides and working in the tourism industry. So you could see a lot of the scar on their bodies. They have scars, dents on their backs, because elephants actually can't carry the weight of, you know, say, like a you know, 2 or 3 passengers and, you know, a basket to carry those passengers. They're just not built for that kind of work. So there's a lot of, you know, deformed bodies and things like that.
So it's heartbreaking.
Yes, it was sad, you know, but, you know, how we kind of got through it was just knowing that, hey, we're going to help these guys live out the rest of their lives as, you know, as peacefully and as happily as they possibly can. So, yeah.
Wow. So is there a campaign to stop the abuse? Or it's just an industry that's very difficult to...
It's difficult because I was told by the folks who do run the rescue that, you know, wildlife tourism still is very profitable as an industry. And a lot of people still just, they're not aware that they're supporting something that exploits wildlife. So...
Well, Stephanie, what's next on your agenda?
Oh, sure. Yeah, you know, right now, I think at this point, I'm still going to continue to always be a champion for the underdog. I think that
that's
in general,
wonderful.
That's what I'm going to be. I'm going to continue using my platform and my voice for that purpose. I'm currently, as you know, also working on building out my YouTube channel. So before I had that program Sandbox, where I interviewed different startup founders and entrepreneurs. And so now I think I'm going to transition that from a podcast into more of a video channel as well. So people can check that out online. It's just youtube.com/slynshady, which is my online alias. So always welcome comments and subscriptions there.
That's where you can find Stephanie Lin. She's Miss Asian America, and she's been doing a lot for the world. It's been great talking with you about all that you've been doing.
Thank you.
And
likewise.
We look forward to hearing and seeing more of you.
Oh, thank you very much, Natalie.
And thank you today for tuning in to Taiwan Today. I'm Natalie So.